Thank you for the cross, for Christ, who through his death on that cross has made it possible for us to have eternal life. And thank you that it's the death of Christ that, and his following resurrection that not only saves us, but also sanctifies us and satisfies us. And is all that we need. So Lord, I pray that this night you would exercise that power of the cross in hearts of women all across this auditorium. May there be prison chains that are broken loose, captives set free, as we say yes to Christ. Help us again this night to preach the gospel to our own hearts. And through that, to find new, abundant, eternal life through Christ our Lord, in whose great name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And I want to let you know that the women in that prison are praying for us tonight and would be here if they could. But they have been with us, haven't they? And aren't you grateful for the grace of God in the lives of those women? Thank you, Stacy. Thank you, Keith and Kristen and team there, and Brother Crawford for ministering to us so powerfully tonight. Now, I know a lot of you have come a long distance. You've had a long day. How many of you are just like really tired? Can I see some hands? That's why we've chilled it off in here. Keep you from falling asleep. We can make it colder if you start to nod. I'm going to make a promise to you. I know it's late. I know you're tired. So I promise I'm going to get you out of here tonight by 9 o'clock. How's that? Pacific time. Let me ask you to open your Bible. I have no more comments about time or tiredness or temperature. Just endure, okay? This is boot camp for being true women. We're going to learn not to complain. Let me ask you to open to the book of Titus. I hope you brought your Bible with you, paper as it is, or electronic, or whatever version you use these days. If you don't have one, feel free to look on with somebody near you. But we're going to use our Bibles. We have already, and we're going to use them through the weekend. You may as well just keep it real nearby, because you're going to want it open on your lap. And some of you are type A, you got to write everything down sort of people. Firstborns, I know I am one. You will like die if you try to get down everything you hear this weekend. So don't even try. It's all being recorded. It's all going to be available in the Resource Center. There'll be DVDs of the plenary sessions, CDs of everything else. And you can take that home with you. You can listen to it over and over again. And some of them you will want to do that. But let me just encourage you to be writing down particularly the words that the Spirit wings to your heart. And the things that you say, ooh, I needed that. I don't want to forget that. And jot down those things and put a circle around them or underline them something so that you can go back and refresh and renew yourself in what God has said and ponder it tonight and in the morning and in the days and weeks ahead as we continue to respond to the Lord. I want us tonight to look at a passage that's familiar to many of us. I'm actually going to take us to Titus 2, although I'm going to start in chapter 1. But we want to answer three questions tonight from Titus chapter 2. And let me just tell you what the questions are, and then we'll walk through the passage. The first question is, what does it mean to be a true woman? What does it mean to be a true woman? If somebody asked you, if Paula came to you with that mic in front of your face and says, what is a true woman? Could you answer better than the women that we saw on that DVD a little bit ago? What would you say? What is a true woman? What does a true woman look like? We're going to see a description of a true woman, a portrait in this passage. Then the second question we want to ask is, how can we become true women of God? We've heard the starting place tonight. You can't be God's true woman until you are God's. And what a great place to start. And I want to pick up from there and say, how can we become God's true women? And then the third question we'll look at tonight is, what difference does it make? So what about all of this? Does it really matter? And why does it matter that we would be God's true women? What does a true woman look like? How can we be true women? And does it really matter? Now, let me give you some context for this familiar passage in Titus chapter 2. Sometimes we just jump right into the passage and we don't see the setting that helps us understand more about the passage we're looking at. As you know, the Apostle Paul is writing to Titus, who is the pastor of the church on the island of Crete. Now, Crete was legendary in the ancient world for its immorality. There was a lot of false teaching, as we'll see in just a moment, that had led to ungodly living. Because as we've been reminded tonight, what you think has a direct connection to how you live. They had wrong thinking, which led to wrong, wicked lifestyles. And if you'll look at the last paragraph of chapter 1, beginning in verse 10, there's a description of the culture in which this church existed. The surrounding culture in which these believers were required to live as believers in Christ. So look at verse 10 of chapter 1. The Apostle Paul says, "There are many who are insubordinate, empty talkers, and deceivers." Look at verse 11. "They are upsetting whole families by teaching for shameful gain what they ought not to teach. One of the Cretans, a prophet of their own, said, 'Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons.'" And Paul just was quoting one of their own writers of the day. He says, I don't have to tell you. Listen to what your own people say. They're always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons. And then Paul adds his PS in verse 13. This testimony is true. There's no doubt about it. Look at verse 15. The end of verse 15. "Their minds and their consciences are defiled. They profess to know God, but they deny Him by their works. They're detestable, disobedient, unfit for any good work." Now, does that description sound at all familiar to you? I look at that description and I think, I don't know a better way to describe the day in which we live. The world in which we live and in which we're trying to survive and thrive and be conquerors through Christ, the day in which we live, we just saw a great description of that at the end of chapter 1. And so Paul is speaking to a pastor and to believers who are living in a decadent world. And it's easy for believers in an age like theirs or like ours to begin to get discouraged, to feel overwhelmed by the flood tide of wickedness. How do you live in that kind of world? How do you survive as a believer in Christ? How do we maintain the purity of the body of Christ? And beyond that, how do we penetrate the darkness and reach out to that kind of culture? Now, it's interesting to me that the counsel Paul gives to those believers, and what I think he would say to us today, is not what we might have expected. For example, he doesn't say, as you might read in many books today, "Church, what you need to do is become more culturally relevant. You need to get more in tune with your culture, and you need to be a little bit more like it so they can identify with you and be drawn to Christ." Paul doesn't say, "You know, you really need to spruce up your strategy, your plans, your programs." He doesn't talk about any of that. Look at what he says in the very next verse, chapter 2, and this is where we're going to park for these last moments tonight. Chapter 2, verse 1. "But as for you," what do you do in this kind of world? "As for you, Pastor Titus, and as for you, believers who are listening to this word, this counsel, teach what accords with sound doctrine." Sound doctrine? That's your answer for living in a world that is detestable, disobedient, defiled, their consciences are... That's your counsel? Sound doctrine? Doctrine doesn't sound very exciting, does it? Some might be tempted to say, "I don't even know if that would be very effective. It sounds boring. It doesn't sound like something people are going to be interested in." And sadly, many so-called believers in our churches couldn't care less about sound doctrine today, and that is one of our huge problems. The word sound there in our English language comes from a word in the Greek from which we get our word hygiene. It's a word that means healthy, sound, vital, hygienic. Hygiene really matters in the physical realm, and it really matters in the spiritual realm. Hygienic, sound doctrine or teaching. And I just want to suggest here as a starting place about what is a true woman, what does she look like, that a true woman is tethered to the Word of God. Her life is anchored to truth, the truth that we find in God's Word. It's the Word of God, it's the truth that determines and governs her thinking, her behavior, her attitudes, her emotions. It's all grounded in the Word of God, sound doctrine. So how to transform or impact a wicked culture like that in Crete? There's a tendency to think what we really need are new or better laws to address these issues. We need new structures, new systems, new social programs. We need to overhaul the judicial system, the schools, the government, the economy. We need a different president. We need a different Congress. We need a different something. But Paul insists that what the world really needs, what the world most needs, is Christians who actually live out what they claim to believe. The things that accord with sound doctrine. Christians who are godly and wise and kind and known for good works and who have ordered family relationships. You see, ladies, the world will never be convinced by our arguments about the reality of God or about moral issues, abortion, same-sex marriage. It's not our arguments that are going to persuade the world. The world is going to be persuaded as they see the reality of the gospel lived out in our lives and our relationships. That's why there's such a desperate need in the church today to teach sound doctrine. And to teach its implications, the so what of sound doctrine. And so Paul addresses in the book of Titus and in virtually all of his other epistles in the New Testament, what is sound doctrine, what is sound doctrine, and then what does it look like in life? Sound doctrine has practical applications for each gender, each season of life, each social position. It has implications for you. Whether you are 14 or 94 or somewhere in between, whether you are married or single, have children or not, whether you work in the home, out of the home, both, whatever your season, your station, your situation in life, sound doctrine has implications for you. And that's what Paul talks about in Titus. Now, he begins in verse 2 by saying, as he's addressing these different seasons of life, older men are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Paul says this is what sound doctrine produces or looks like in older men. Now, I don't see many men here tonight, and even if there were, I'm not called to preach to men. God called me to speak to women, so I'm going to move past that verse and let Brother Crawford and Bob Lapine and others preach that verse when you get to your church on Sunday. But I want to pick up with verses 3-5, where Paul then turns to what does sound doctrine look like in women? What does it mean to be a true woman? What does a true woman look like? And he starts with older women. And then he moves to younger women. So let me read verses 3-5. Older women likewise are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good and so train the young women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. Now, let's start with the older women, and for starters there, you might just wonder, how do you know if you're an older woman? Well, if you're wondering, you probably are. You know, they say old age is always 15 years older than however old you are at the time, right? Now, in the context of Scripture and in that day and throughout the Scripture, I think that older women would specifically refer to women who are past childbearing years, women who are in their 50s and 60s and beyond. And I have to confess to you that since I've been a little girl, I've always had this deep heart desire to be a godly old lady. I don't know where this came from, but I always had this picture in my mind of what a godly old lady looks like, and that's what I've been always wanting to be. And then as I hit my 50s, I realized that the getting old part comes easier than the getting godly part, in case you're wondering. But you know, women, all of us are older women to someone. And you teenage girls, I am so glad that you are here this weekend, because so many of the older women in this room would love to have learned decades ago the things that God is teaching you at this season of life as you're becoming true women of God. And aren't we wanting to cheer for those teenage girls? And young women, you are older women to the younger women around you. So don't tune me out while I'm talking to the older women, okay? You need to listen. Besides, even if you think I am eons away from being an older woman, first of all, it comes a whole lot faster than you are ever dreaming it will. But besides that, this is what you're to aspire to. This is what you are to be becoming. And in Titus 2, verses 3 through 5, we have a template, a pattern for a true woman. All of us are to aspire to this and to hold our lives up to this beautiful picture in the Scripture. Now, let me tell you, tonight I'm going to give you as quick a bird's eye view as I can of this passage. I'm just going to skim the surface of it, but I'll tell you that in the Resource Center, we have a CD series where I spent weeks talking through verse by verse, word by word, phrase by phrase through this passage. That's available. It's called God's Beautiful Design for Women. And if you want to go deeper in this study or in what it means to be a true woman of God, let me encourage you to consider looking at that resource. Now, first, Paul addresses the character or the lifestyle of a true woman. What does a true woman look like? Well, here's what her character looks like. And then he's going to look at her calling. But first, her character. What does her lifestyle look like? Well, it says in verse 3 that she is reverent in behavior. I like one of the translations there that says that she is to exhibit behavior fitting for those who are holy. Women, if you're a child of God, the Scripture calls you a saint, a set-apart one, a holy one, and we are to exhibit behavior that is fitting for those who are saints, for those who are holy. She is reverent in behavior. You say, well, what does that look like? You always talk in hushed tones. What does reverent mean? Well, reverent in behavior affects the way that we talk and the way that we walk. So he goes on to say, reverent in behavior, not slanderers, or slaves to much wine. Why? Because those things, slander and substance abuse, are not fitting for those who are holy. Not slanderers. That has to do with our tongue and not just the words we say, but at the heart of that is how we treat others. What is our heart attitude toward them? That comes out in the way we talk to and about them. So we're not to be slanderers. And then he says, older women, you are not to be slaves to much wine. And I remember when I first started studying this passage, I'm thinking, Paul only mentions three things about older women: reverent in behavior, not slanderers, and not slaves to much wine. Why did he pick that one? Were all the older women in Crete going around getting drunk, or what was the issue? And it's easy for those of us who are not addicted to much wine to just kind of move past this and say, well, that doesn't apply to me. I think the principle here is a lot broader than alcohol addiction. What he's talking about here represents a spirit or a mindset of indulgence, self-indulgence. And as we get older, it's easy to think, I've paid my dues, I've worked hard, I deserve a break today, I'm going to just do what makes me feel good. And Paul says, no. That's not what the gospel looks like on an older woman. Paul is talking here about a temperate lifestyle, that we are not to use substances as an escape from emotional pain. We are not to live for self or pleasure or fulfilling our senses. We are to live for Christ, for God, and that involves a temperate lifestyle. So we see the character of a true woman. And then we see the calling or the mission of a true woman. In verse 3, it says she is to teach what is good and so train the young women. Now, just an observation here, and that is that character comes before calling. Life comes before ministry. We can't teach others, moms, grandmoms, disciples, older women in the church. We cannot teach others what we are not living ourselves, what we have not learned ourselves. And I think that's one of the reasons that there are so few older women in the church today mentoring the younger women. Because we know in our heart of hearts that we aren't practicing a lifestyle that is befitting of the gospel, so we don't have anything to share with them. And so Paul says, get something to share with them. Get a lifestyle that is worthy of being followed, worthy of being emulated, so that you can fulfill your calling. I got an email from a woman not too long ago who said, I'm entering the empty nest phase, and my role as a full-time stay-at-home mom is no longer needed. That was my life stream, and I've lived it, and it's over. Now what? I'm questioning who I am and why I'm here. I feel so lost, so confused. I've been asking God to give me direction and to show me what I can be doing in this next part of my life. I need to know it can be exciting, because right now it feels like a big mess, lonely and depressing. Well, Titus 2 gives you, if you happen to feel that way, some of you entering that empty nest phase of life, it gives you the direction, the mission, and the purpose that you've been looking for. As older women, they have been walking with God, living exemplary lives. They have faithfully raised and trained their own children. And now Paul says they are to teach and train other women who are in the childbearing, child-rearing years or season. And how do you do that training? You do it by your life, and you do it by intentional connecting with those younger women to help teach them, to help train them in the ways of God. Paul says, older women, this is not a time, a season in your life to retire, to take it easy, to indulge yourself. Ladies, we need to keep our heads in the game. Those younger women need us to be intentional about living lives that make them thirsty for Jesus and calling them to follow Christ and showing them what the gospel looks like in their lives as we demonstrate it in our own lives. And I want to remind us that this kind of teaching, training, ministry does not by and large happen from the pulpit. Not to say that we don't need men and pastors teaching us, but as women, our ministry to other women doesn't mostly happen one to many. Some of you think, people come up to me and say, I'd like to teach the word like you do. And I hope you love the word. I hope you're teaching it to others. But I want to tell you where this kind of mentoring and discipleship takes place. It is life to life. It's in the context of the laboratory of life as you do life with other women and they see your life and they ask you to pray for them and you encourage them and you point them to the scripture and you take them to God's throne of grace. It's life to life. There can be more of this kind of mentoring and discipling taking place in your kitchen, at your dining room table, or as you sort laundry together, as you walk together, literally walking partners perhaps, than may take place in a formal class. Classroom setting. The implications of sound doctrine we need to be passing on to the next generation, how they live out the gospel, we communicate that to them, incarnate that truth out of our lives, and then call them to live that truth. Now, a lot of women get to that older woman season of life, and all of us to some extent get there and think, I've blown it. My life isn't exemplary. Can I tell you, you can even teach out of your failures. If you get to the cross and you learn how to get God's mercy and grace for your failures. I got an email just recently from a woman who said, I'm 79 years old. And I realize how self-centered my life has been. And how many times I missed the opportunities to serve my Lord and be the example I should have been. Hearing what a true woman should be has pierced my heart. I have failed so miserably. However, she said, your message on the radio this morning spoke to my heart and made me realize that as weak as I am right now, I'm battling some illnesses, As an older woman, I need to encourage and be the example and shine the light of Christ in any way I can to the four generations in my family and to friends and acquaintances. Ladies, some of you have been taking for years. You've been sitting in one Bible study after another. You've been through every class Precept has to offer. You've been through every year of Bible study fellowship. You've been through every Beth Moore course that there is, or whatever it is that you do in your church. You've had it all. You've heard it all. And could I just say, great. Now you need to take what you've heard, what you've received, and you need to plant it like a seed in the hearts of the women around you. You need to become a giver. If you've had truth poured into you, you need to turn around and give it out, pour it out, invest in the lives of the women around you, particularly in the women of the next generation. So, what are the older women to teach the younger women? Well, thankfully, Paul gives us a curriculum here, and we read it beginning in the end of verse 3. They are to teach what is good, and so train the young women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husbands. Now, unless you've been in a closet for the last 30 years and have had no connection to the culture, you realize that them's fighting words in our culture. Those words are really, really countercultural. They are radical. They are not politically correct. But can I just remind us that that is God's way? And that God says these things are good. Teach what is good. We need to remember when we're teaching God's ways to others that these are not burdensome. These are a delight. These are the way to experience God's blessing and the fullness of His goodness in your life. These things are good and beautiful because they are true and they are a reflection of God's greatness and goodness. Now, rather than delving into each of these points, let me just make a few observations about that list. These qualities are what flow out of believing sound doctrine. You can know your Bible backward and forward. You can call yourself a Christian. You can be active in ministry. But if you do not exhibit behavior fitting for those who are holy, if you use your tongue to slander others, if you are self-indulgent or you have an addictive lifestyle, if you don't love your husband and children, if you're not self-controlled, if you're not morally pure, if you're not managing your home well, if you're not kind, if you're not submissive to your own husband, then profess what you want about being a Christian. Something is wrong with that picture. So many, many professing believers today who have this huge gap, this fundamental disconnect between what they say they believe and the way they live. And according to Scripture, no such separation is legitimate. By its very nature, the gospel transforms the way that we live. You cannot claim to be a saved woman and not live like a saved woman. Your lifestyle either proves, it validates, or disproves your claim to be a child of God. The gospel, the grace of God, should make our lives distinctive in the way that we think, the way that we act, the way we talk, the way we dress, eat, drink, everything being done for His glory, the furthering of His reign and rule in this world. I love what that woman in the prison video said. He is changing everything about me. And if you are a growing child of God, then you should be able to say, He is changing everything about me. So this is what flows out of sound doctrine. And then I see in this passage the priority that God places on the home. Four of the qualities four of the seven qualities in this list, relate specifically to marriage and family. And there seems to be an assumption made by the Apostle Paul here that young women will be wives and mothers. This is God's norm. It shows the value that he places on that calling. It is no insignificant thing to be a wife, to be a mother. It's not just like you drift through life and, oh yeah, you fall in love, you get married, you have children, it's just part of the story. No, it's part of God's plan and his story. It's part of his way of revealing his redemptive heart and plan. Now, 1 Corinthians 7 tells us that God has called and gifted some to be able to stay single for the purpose of serving God in a more concentrated way. But those are the exceptions, not the rule. And so we see that our homes are the first and primary sphere where we as women live out the gospel. Again, if we're not living it there, something's wrong. And then I see in this list the priority of love. We are called to reflect the love of God, first to those within the four walls of our homes and then to others. Ladies, let me just say it again. You can't claim to love God if you don't love your husband and your children. It's one thing for the people at work or in your church or your small group to think of you as a sweet, loving, gracious, true woman and friend. But what if we were to ask your family? You see, that's a starting place. The testing place for true love is at home. If it doesn't work there, it doesn't work. Now, you may be thinking, and I know we have women coming from a lot of different and some very difficult home situations, and you're sitting here thinking, how can I love that man? How can I love that child, that prodigal who's breaking my heart, or that two-year-old for whom no textbook was ever written? You know which one I'm talking about? How can I love that mate, that child? Well, this passage says you can learn. These things don't always come naturally. They do need to be trained. They do need to be taught. But there's also a provision made here, and we'll see it in just a few moments, of God's supernatural grace to enable you to love in the most difficult, even impossible situations. So throughout the book of Titus, we see, and we saw it here in these verses, that the lives of believers should be radically different than those who do not believe. Our culture is characterized by the kinds of things we read about at the end of chapter 1. Violence, sexual promiscuity, greed, lying, gluttony, drunkenness, rebellion, hatred, anger. You see these things, descriptions of the world throughout the book of Titus. But because of how the gospel of Christ has changed us, our lives are supposed to look different. They're supposed to be countercultural. And the world is supposed to be able to look at us as Christian women and see a massive difference. See that our lives are characterized by things like love, gentleness, purity, self-control, truthfulness, submissiveness, well-ordered family relationships. We are expected to be a living demonstration of the gospel, to make the gospel believable. And so as we look at this list, and you could do this all through the book of Titus, but let me just show you a bit of it starting in the verses we've just looked at in Titus 2, verse 1. You see this list of how a Christian or Christian woman in verses 3 through 5 is to reflect or illustrate the gospel. And I want to just walk through those qualities again, just real quickly here, and just have us consider what would it look like if a woman is not grounded in truth and is not living out the gospel? For example, in verse 1, we see that a Christian woman bases her life on sound doctrine, the truth, the word of God. But a woman whose life is not informed or shaped by the gospel is going to minimize the importance of doctrine, will ignore or disregard it, and that woman's life is going to be based on beliefs that are not true, that are not sound. The godly woman, the woman whose life has been informed by the gospel of Christ, we read in verses 2 through 3 that older believers are to model godliness and spiritual maturity. They are to be intentional about passing the baton, investing the gospel, the faith in the next generation, intentional about discipling and mentoring the next generation. But what if the gospel does not inform our lives? What does that look like? Older people are set free to pursue their own dreams, their own pleasures, to retire, to have the easy life, to live their own way. They've paid their dues and they want to spend the rest of their life seeing the USA in their Chevrolet or whatever, traveling around in their RV, hobbies, whatever. Just take it easy. That's a lifestyle that is not informed by the gospel. In verse 3, we see that older women whose lives have been shaped by the gospel are to be reverent in behavior. But a woman whose life is not shaped or informed by the gospel is going to be secular, coarse, or vulgar. Women whose lives have been shaped by the gospel are not slanderers. They are to speak the truth, words that build up. But if our lives have not been shaped by the gospel, we're going to have loose lips. We're going to wound others with our words. The woman whose life is built on sound doctrine and informed by the gospel is not going to be a slave to much wine. She's going to have a temperate lifestyle. But a woman for whom the gospel doesn't matter or mean anything is going to be self-indulgent. She will have addictive behavior, substance abuse, eating disorders, live for pleasure, live for senses, medicate emotional pain. A woman whose life is shaped by the gospel will teach what is good. She will train younger women. But what happens in a model where the gospel does not speak into the life is we devalue what older people have to offer. We make them feel useless or marginalized. And younger women are left adrift to fend for themselves. And so many of them, sadly, don't make it. They end up shipwrecked. We see that the gospel-informed woman, the younger women, are to love their husbands. They are to value marriage. They are to be covenant keepers, even when it's hard, when it hurts, when it seems so difficult. But in the culture or the climate where the gospel does not inform the way we live, women will resent their husbands. They will dishonor them, neglect them, leave them. And this is where we have the divorce culture, disposable marriages. The gospel-informed woman will love her children. She will value motherhood. She will value having children according to the will and plan of God and be intentional about shaping their lives for Christ. But in a culture and in a mindset that is not informed by the gospel, women are discouraged from having children in the first place. And then when they do have them, they either abuse them or spoil them, perhaps let others raise them. They're not intentional about discipling them to be followers of Christ. A woman whose life is informed by the gospel will be self-controlled. That's a word that I found myself parking on, camping on a lot in recent days. It's a word sophron in the Greek. It means to have a saved or sound mind. A sophron state of mind is what enables us to curb fleshly desires, and it results in our practicing self-control in every area of our lives, our tongue, habits, sexuality, every area of our lives. But a woman whose life is not controlled, is not bounded by the gospel, has no self-control. She's out of control. Spending habits, her tongue, her use of time. She will be impetuous, impulsive. Whatever she thinks, she just says it. Her mind is not sophron. It is not a saved, sound mind. And so we see the woman whose life is informed by the gospel will be pure in her heart, her mind, her sexuality, versus immodesty, sexual permissiveness, promiscuity. A woman who is a gospel-oriented woman will value the home. She will have a heart for home. Her focus and her priorities will involve her home. But what does the world do? Where the gospel doesn't have a say, we devalue homemaking. Hospitality has become a thing of the past. Our homes are in a state of chaos. We're yanking women out of the home and elevating the work they do out of the home above the work they could be doing in and for their homes. And so you see all through this passage and through the book of Titus how a gospel-informed life looks qualitatively different than a life that is not informed by the gospel. So the question is, how well does your life, how well does my life reflect the gospel and the grace of God? And what it looks like to be a redeemed woman? Now, as I look at these qualities, just the few we've talked about, and there are others throughout the book of Titus, I come across a problem. I see this incredible portrait of a true woman. I see what she looks like. I see her character. I see her calling to pass a legacy of godliness on to the next generation. But here's my problem. I can't live that way. I can't be that kind of woman. And you know what? Neither can you. And recognizing that problem is the first step to dealing with it. We don't have the power. Christ is calling us to live a life that is impossible for us to live. We can't do it. And the sooner we recognize that, the better. We do not have the power to live this kind of life. How many of you within the past week, just think back, would say there has been at least one moment, maybe more, when I look back and I say, I was not thinking, acting, looking, talking, whatever, like a true woman. Can you just remember? Okay, maybe like in the past day, past hour. Oh, you know what? I can get out of my quiet time and within 3 minutes or less, I'm living like a pagan. Talking like a pagan, not like a true woman. And I go, oh, why do I act that way? Why do I talk that way? Why did I say that? Why am I thinking that? How can we become true women of God? Well, verses 11 through 14 give us three resources, and I wish we could do a whole message just on this. I'm just going to touch on them, and you can go back and explore their marvels for yourself. But three resources that will enable us to be God's true women who live in accord with sound doctrine. The first one, a present resource, is the grace of God. In the present, look at verses 11 and 12. The grace of God, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age. The grace of God. That is a resource God gives to me every moment of every day that right here and now will enable me, not just in this auditorium, but when I go home, when I'm in the workplace, when I'm in, you know, when I'm being squeezed and what's the flesh is coming out, the grace of God is what will give me the desire and the power to live according to sound doctrine. And then chapter 3 reminds us that it wasn't always that way. We didn't always have the grace of God. We didn't always live as true women. We used to be just like the world. Look at verse 3 of chapter 3. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. Whether you remember or not, whether you realize it or not, that's who we were before Christ came and changed our lives. So what made the difference? What changed us? Look at verse 4 of chapter 3. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, He saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy. Verse 7, so that being justified by His grace, grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. I cannot be saved by human effort or willpower, and I cannot be sanctified by human effort or willpower. I cannot be God's true woman, and nor can you, apart from His grace. If you try and live this life on your own, you will become hopeless. You will live a despairing life. You will constantly feel like a failure because you will be a failure. And you will be living under the law, living in bondage. Or if you don't fail, you will strive and struggle and be rigid and uptight. And no one will want what you have as you're trying to be a true woman. It's God's grace that enables us to say no to the flesh and yes to God. In the present, we have the grace of God. What an incredible resource. And then there's a future-looking resource, and that is the return of Christ. Verse 13, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Keep your eyes on the finish line. And remember, it will be worth it all. When? When we see Christ. When we see him, the process of being conformed to his image will be complete. We will be forever with the Lord. When you get weary here, when you feel like giving up here, God will use the reminder, that blessed hope of the return of Christ, to be something that will infuse you with strength and desire to press into the battle and to be God's true woman. And then as we reflect on the past, we have a third resource. It's found in verse 14. It's the power of the cross, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. It's the gospel of Christ that is the source of all godliness, and we are called to live our lives in light of what Christ has already done for us on the cross, where he died our death in our place for our sin, so that we might be clothed in his righteousness and be true women of God. Let me say that if you have never been to the cross to repent of your sin and place your faith in Jesus Christ, you can't even be in the game as a true woman of God. And I believe there are many women here this weekend that God brought you here because he wanted to bring you to faith in Jesus Christ. As you reflect on what Christ has done for you and you just lift your eyes up to him and you say, yes, Lord, I believe you did it for me. Make me your child so that I can become your true woman who brings glory to you. Now, just briefly here, so what? Does all this really matter? How much does it really matter? Is it all that important? Why do women need to learn these things? Why do we need to practice these things? And what's at stake? What happens if we don't live this way? Well, Titus 2, the passage we've been reading and beyond, gives instructions to believers who are in various seasons and stations in life. And repeatedly, Paul says, here's what the gospel looks like on you. And in this passage, Paul includes three purpose clauses. This is the so what. This is why it matters. Look at these three clauses. First, in verse 5. Why does it matter? So that the word of God may not be reviled. Verse 8. So that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. And verse 10. So that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. Ladies, there is so much more at stake here than our own individual lives. There's this ripple effect of our lives that goes so much further than most of us realize. You say, you know, yeah, people who speak at conferences like this, they need to be true women for sure. My pastor's wife, she needs to be a true woman. The women's ministry director, the person who leads our study group, she needs to be a true woman. But what does it really matter if I'm a true woman? It matters hugely. You do not realize the impact that your life has on an unbelieving world and others around us. As we make the gospel believable or not, by the extent to which our lives reflect sound doctrine and the gospel of Christ. So as unbelievers look at the Christians, quote, that they know, if they see us being lazy, addicted, having rebellious kids, marriage conflicts, immorality, dysfunctional relationships, being unkind with our tongues, with our attitudes, not sophron, not self-control, what conclusions do they draw about Christianity? Does your life cause your husband, your kids, or others to disrespect or to doubt God's word? Does it give them ammunition to attack what you say you believe? Or does your life adorn, enhance the doctrine of Christ? It was a 19th century German philosopher who said, "Show me your redeemed life, and I might be inclined to believe in your Redeemer." What difference does it make if you and I live godly lives in an ungodly world? Ladies, your life, your family, may be one tiny island of godliness in a huge sea of wickedness. But that's how the kingdom of God spreads. As they see your light, they see Christ in you, and they are drawn to him, and they are drawn to believe. They are compelled to repent of their sin, to believe the gospel, to turn to Christ. Don't underestimate the impact of being God's true woman, having the character and fulfilling the calling of a true woman of God. Last Friday morning, I received a call that a cousin had died suddenly during the night. Ruth Ozinga was 61 years old. She had become a dear friend in more recent years. I'd gotten to know her better. She was a prayer warrior for our ministry and a true, true woman of God. She had been married to her husband, Marty, for 40 years. They had 6 sons who were in their 20s and 30s, and now 6 daughters-in-law as of this year. The last one got married. As of next month, they will have 16 grandchildren, ages 8 and under. And there's a picture here of the family. We'll get it up there in just a sec. But it was taken 4 years ago, so there are only 3 grandchildren in that picture because there have been 11 born since. I don't know if my math is right. Something like that. Yeah, they're 15 now. The 15th was born last Wednesday. On Thursday, Ruth held that newborn in her arms. And Thursday night, during the night, Ruth went to be with the Lord. I had the privilege of attending her memorial service yesterday morning in Chicago and was asked to share briefly some reflections on her life at that service, as did 2 of her sons and 2 of her brothers. The outpouring of love and affection for her and the tributes about her life were just unbelievable. I wasn't there the night before for the visitation, but I understand that for 7 hours, the people stood 500 in line at all times to get to speak to the family, to express their affection for Ruth and their memories of her. 3,000 to 4,000 people, I was told, who attended that visitation. But as I was at that funeral service yesterday, the memorial service, I just listened to people talk about the impact she had had in their lives. People who knew her, who loved her, people who had been childhood friends, stayed friends with her through life, her children, her daughters-in-law. I just listened to many people talk about the impact of her life. And what I knew of her and what I heard them describe is exactly what we have been looking at in Titus chapter 2. I heard the story of a woman of godly character. A woman, for example, rather than slandering, she used her tongue to speak words of blessing and encouragement and grace. Somebody sent me an email and said, "I never heard Ruth speak a single word of complaint or criticism." And I thought, let's just start there. You know, I mean, how incredible would it be for someone to be able to say that about my life, about our lives? I was sharing this at the dinner table last night, and someone at the table said, "It's too late." I'm not sure if they were talking about me or them. And it is too late for somebody to say they've never heard me say a word of complaint or criticism, but you know what? It's not too late for me to get to the cross and get God's grace to begin to live as that kind of woman. I heard about a woman who was reverent in behavior, who was modest in her spirit, in her demeanor. She'd walk into a room, she never took over, never drew attention to herself, but when she would speak, people would stop and listen because she was a woman filled with wisdom, filled with the Word of God, always encouraging people to pursue God in His ways. She was kind, she was an encourager, she was the queen of hospitality. Used her home just as a station for blessing people, her family, and others outside her home. She's a woman, and this came out over and over and over again, who loved her husband, who loved him well, who loved him faithfully, who grew in her love for him, and he blossomed, he bloomed, he flourished under her love, in the context, in the environment of her love. And Marty Ozinga is a great servant of the Lord, a man of God, a Christian businessman whose life has been blessed by his wife's love. Her 6 sons talking about her impact in their lives. One of them pulled me aside after the funeral and he said, "You have to understand, though all these boys are walking with the Lord today and married to godly gals who are walking with the Lord, one of them said to me, it was not always this way. At one point or another, every one of us boys was not walking with the Lord and was giving our mom fits. She did a lot of parenting on her knees as she cried out to the Lord on behalf of her children. And when it was appropriate, she would get in their faces. One of them told it, he gave a tribute at the memorial service, and he told it about how a number of years ago, 2 years into his marriage, he was living in California. He was in sinful bondage, living in an addictive sin habit. His marriage was falling apart. They were getting ready to break up the marriage, and Ruth got on a plane, flew out to California, got in his face and said, "Son, you don't break up this marriage, not on my watch." And she went to battle for the soul of that son and for the soul of that marriage. And here he was standing yesterday saying how much he loves his wife now that they've been married 11 years, sitting in front of on the second row there listening to him, to see these boys loving the Lord, their wives loving the Lord, and these precious grandchildren spread around who are growing up in godly Christian families. And I just said, this is a national treasure. All the lives that have been impacted by this one quiet, true woman who would have been embarrassed to hear what they said about her at the funeral. She'd be embarrassed to hear what I'm saying today. She didn't want any of the attention for herself. She was always pointing people's attention to Christ. And her life left the fragrance of Christ. She cared so much about legacy. In fact, at the last extended family reunion, she's Greek. This is a part of my big Greek family. And she gave out torches to each family at that reunion and challenged them. She and her husband, Marty, did challenge these families to keep in this torch of faith burning brightly in their own home and then to pass it to the next generation. And at first I was really sad, and I still am to some extent, as I think about those precious grandchildren who will never know Grandma Ruth, will not have the influence of her life here on earth, taken so young. But then I looked down at those precious daughters-in-law, and I thought, she prayed those girls into this family. She prayed those sons to faith, she and her husband working together. God did the work. She would take no credit for it. She cared about legacy, and she left her mark, and she left her imprint. And for generations to come, long after everyone who was at that service is dead and gone, she will still be speaking. Her impact, the ripple effect of her impact, will be continuing for generations to come as they pass the torch, the baton of faith on. Now, it's easy to look at a life like that and think, well, that's somebody else's story. But my life is so messed up. My family is so dysfunctional. My past is so whatever. Ladies, that's what grace is for. That's what the cross is about. And God is saying to you tonight, you can be, even in this sea of wickedness around you, you can be, by God's grace, His true woman. Doing the battle on your knees, having the character of a true woman and fulfilling the calling of a true woman to pass that baton of faith on to others around you. Being intentional, not just wandering your way through life, but saying, God has put me here on this planet for a purpose, and by God's grace, Lord, I will be that true woman to fulfill your holy purposes in my world for this generation. And I take that applause to mean that that is what you affirm in your heart as your desire. Ladies, one day, and sooner than most of us realize, and I want you high school kids to listen to me too, because you don't think you're ever going to die. And some of us didn't used to think we were ever going to die. But you go to enough funerals, and I watch a woman who's 9 years older than I am lying in a casket yesterday. One day it's going to be you. It's going to be me. People are going to come and gather. And probably at the funeral they'll say some nice things, even if you didn't live a nice life. They find a way to say nice things at funerals. But what I really care about for my life and for yours is, what will be the impact of our life after the casket's closed? It's lowered into the ground. Dirt's poured on top. People sooner or later forget our name. But will the fragrance, the perfume, the beauty of Christ continue to move from one generation to the next because we were here? As I sat at that funeral yesterday, the words of a song came to mind. They didn't use it at the funeral, but it would have been very appropriate there. And I'd like to close our time tonight by just reading to you the lyrics of what for many of you is a familiar song. We're pilgrims on the journey of a narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race, not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. After all our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind, may the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must find. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Would you bow your hearts with me in prayer? Lord, I thank you for letting me see just yesterday this powerful reminder of a faithful life, of a true woman of God. And being a true woman isn't about whether you're married or single, children or no children, grandchildren or not. It's about a heart that is tethered to Christ and his word, tethered to the gospel, tethered to the cross, a heart that reflects the beauty of Christ and his ways. And I just pray that you would do something in us tonight and in the days ahead. Give us a fresh, holy desire and passion to be your true women. Pray for older women, middle-aged women, empty nesters, women in the throes of the child-rearing years, newlyweds, single women, teenagers, college students, every season of life. Lord, give us that holy resolve by your grace to let you make us women who make a difference for the fame of your name and the sake of your great kingdom.